Hello, in this session we will be understanding slope development. Now if I say there is a mountain which is lying here, the angle between the valley bottom and the hill top would be known as the angle of slope, and this slope is important to understand the various cycles of erosion. So I can say it's an angular inclination that lies between the hill top and the valley bottom. Now for slope development, we can classify the elements of slope into four parts. The first is the submittal convexity, the free face, rectilinear face and basal concavity. Submittal convexity is a convex slope and it is waxing in nature, that's it is eroding in nature, and this is found towards the hilltop. The next is free face. Free face is usually perpendicular, it's wall-like, it's also known as a scrap. It's a region of steep declination and it's the region where there is no debris, no rockfall activities that could be seen here, and it's predominantly common in the areas of frontal erosion and the regions of parallel retreat. We'll understand parallel retreat once we talk about the various theories of slope development. The next is rectilinear slope. It's the most commonly seen slope. It's usually constant, regular, and it has a uniform slope in most of the regions. The next is basal convexity, concavity. It is concave. As you can see, the slope is concave here. This is the slope which is also known as waning slope. Here the slope nearly ends, or I could say this is the last section of the slope. It is found in the lower basement region and it's most predominant in most of the slope development topographies. Now when we classify the slope, I can classify it based on three criteria. First is the element of slope, the quantitative classification, and the genetic classification. If I say I am classifying slope based on element, I can say there can be various types of slopes like concavo-convex, convexo-concave, so concavo, convexo-concave, that's, then you have concavo-convex, that is, and convexo-rectilinear, that is first it's concave and then it's rectilinear. So there can be kind of various slopes based on the elements of the slope. The four elements that we have talked about, the convex, the free face, the rectilinear and the concavity. So these four, based on these four, you have various mixes and matches which can be seen and you can form the various slope elements. The next is quantitative classification. Quantitative classification talks about the inclination, and usually we say if the slope is very level to gentle, it's 0 to 2 degrees. If it's gentle, it's 2 to 5 degrees. Then you have moderate from 5 to 10 degrees. You have steep from 10 to 18 degrees. And you have kind of vertical slope from 45 to 90 degrees. And among this, if it is near to 45, we call it precipitous. And if it is around 90 degrees, we call it wall-like slope. And finally is the genetic classification. Genetic classification again classifies the slope into three types. The first is the tectonic slope, the erosional slope and the slope of accumulation. So tectonic slope is formed due to tectonic activities. Erosional slope is due to predominant erosional activities that are seen in the region. And finally you have the slope of accumulation. Slope of accumulation is formed due to the depositional activities that is seen, and these depositional activities are mainly due to the differential denudational patterns that are seen. So these are the three basic classifications of slope that we talk about. The next is the approaches to slope development. When we talk about the approaches to slope development, we can say either I am talking about a process form approach or I am talking about a process evolution, slope evolution approach. When I say slope evolution, I am talking about the historical perspective. How over the period of time the various slopes evolved. So it was, I can say the slope was steeper, then it became gradual and finally it became a gentle slope. So how the slope evolved from, I can say, a steep slope to a gentle slope would be classified under the slope evolution. That's the process of evolution of the slope. And the major issue under slope evolution approach is how to date during which time what was the slope. So understanding the slope with reference to time period is very difficult, because I can say at present this is the slope, but if I want to date it historically, it becomes very difficult. The next is process form approach. Process form approach talks about the direct relationship between the slope and how it was formed. So for example, I can say the region which is rich in limestone in humid areas would form a different kind of landforms or slopes as compared to a limestone which is seen in the fluvial areas. So you can see the process form or how the things are formed, based on that the slope differs. Now this approach specifically states that development of slope is a very sluggish activity, or I could say it's a very slow activity which takes years and years for the slope to be formed. I cannot isolate the process of slope development separately and I can say that this is an individual process or this is a mechanism which would be studied in isolation to all other factors. That is not possible. The reason being, slope is a result of various denudational activities. So if you are talking about slope, you must be familiar with the various denudational processes that are occurring. The next important thing to understand here is, this process form approach explains that slope can either be monoform or monoprocess and polyform or polyprocess. Monoprocess means a particular characteristics or a particular process is creating a particular landform or a particular slope. However, polyprocess means there are numerous landforms that could be created by a single process. So you are talking about creation of numerous slope processes, and you are talking about creation of a single slope process that could be seen here. And it talks about a very good relationship between the climatic conditions and the slope behavior. So these two are the primary approaches that we talk about in slope development process. The next is the models of slope evolution. So when I say the models of slope evolution, we can classify the models into three types. That's the theory of slope decline, slope replacement, and parallel retreat. But before that, let's understand what is slope failure. Slope failure inclines or means there is sudden removal of the slope that is seen, which is known as slope failure. Now, slope failure can be due to various processes. It can be natural, it can be man-made. If I say natural, I can say earthquake, volcano are some of the natural causes which causes change in the slope or which causes slope to fail. And then you have the man-made reasons. These include mining, construction activities, construction of dam, and these are some of the activities which are man-made and affect the slope. Now slope failure is more pronounced in the region where there is a steep slope. So if the slope is a steep, that means the chances of failure are much higher. So if the slope is steep, it's much likely that it could break down or it could fall down, and therefore steeper slopes are more prone to slope failure. That's one thing. Now when I talk about the components of slope, the gravity components of slope can be defined into two parts. One which is parallel to the slope and another that is perpendicular to the slope. The one which is parallel to the slope increases the steepness and there is high risk of collapse. So it has more probability for collapse and it has more steepness. However, the component which is perpendicular to the slope is kind of increasing the frictional activity. And since the frictional activity is increasing, there is decrease in the steepness. Now, this frictional activity is affected by the amount of water that we have inside. Now, if the amount of water is too much, what would happen? If the amount of water is a lot there, the friction would decrease. As a result, there would be more probability of removing the cohesion that exists between the grains. And once there is decrease in the cohesion, it would break off. So perpendicular slopes have more frictional activities and have a probability of decreased steepness. And this is due to the fact that This friction is affected by the amount of water that it has. Okay, so this is how we understand the concept of slope failure. Now, what are the processes that govern the slope failure? Now, there are numerous processes that govern the slope failure, which we would be understanding in the lesson of mass wasting. So, when we talk about mass wasting, we would be talking about three basic terms, that is the fall, the slide, and the creep. So, fall, slide, creep, and slump, I could say. Now, these four are the commonly used terms. We use those with rocks, we use those with muds, and all those details we would be covering under mass wasting. For now, we can simply say, when I say rock fall, it's falling of the particles of the rock. When I say rock slide, that means along the slope side, there is sliding of the particles that occurs to the bottom. Creeping is a kind of slower movement than sliding. And finally, slump. Slump is a movement which flows together. So that is the difference between fall, slide, creep, and slump. So these all would be covered when we will talk about landslides and mass wasting. Now let's move on to the next issue, that is models of slope evolution. Now once we are familiar with the development of the slope, the failure of the slope, we must be able to understand how slope evolved. So there were three opinions propounded by different scholars which explained the various theories on evolution of slope. The first and the foremost was Davis' theory. So Davis, under his theory on cycle of erosion, talked about the landscape formation, and there also he mentioned how the slopes evolved. So he explained that present is a key to past, and his main focus was the declining activities of the slope. Now to understand this, he said the slope is time dependent. So the first thing he talked was it is a time dependent activity. Since it is a time dependent activity, what is happening over the time period, the slope is slowly and gradually waning away. So you have the waning of the slope that could be seen over the time, and that is what he tries to explain under the slope development, slope decline theory. He says his theory mainly focused on humid areas, and he talked about the initial period where the slope was steep, most steep, or I could say it was steepest, and with time the angle of the slope decreased. He also talked about the angle of repose. This is the perpendicular angle to the angle of slope, and he said that this angle keeps on changes or keeps on increasing as you have the slope that is decreasing. So you have the Davis theory that focused on the declining slope. So as you can see here, you have, this was the original level, and with time the slope declined, and this is the final position of the slope that could be seen as given by Davis. The next was Penck's theory. Penck's theory is an interesting theory because he said there is rock mass that is present everywhere, and what happens suddenly is all the rock mass kinds of falls down to the lowest level. So when all the nearby rock mass falls down to the lowest level, what would happen? There would be decrease in the slope at the higher levels. So you have the rock mass that is falling down from all sides, and there would be obviously decline in the slope, and he attributed this to the tectonic activity. So we talked about the three ways of genetic classification, where we talked about the tectonic activities, erosional activities, and the slopes of accumulation. So his main focus was the slope replacement is commonly seen in the areas of tectonic activity. There is flattening of slope that takes place, and maximum angle is decreased by the gentler slopes that are formed. So reduction in the maximum angle as the gentler slopes erode back. So that was his main concern, and as you can see in the diagram here, he explained the first stage where this was the case, where you have A and B at this position. Then the second stage, he said the scree slope B will replace A, so you have the scree slope that is replacing it, and finally you have the slope C that would replace slope B. So this is how he said this was the initial slope, this is the next slope, and this is the final slope that would be seen. So you have a kind of fall that is taking place, and this fall is due to the tectonic process. Then last was the parallel retreat theory, commonly seen in the regions of South Africa. He talked, this was given by King, and King said that these activities are commonly seen in a semi-arid landscape. He also focused that the maximum angle remains constant, but it kind of lowers down with increasing concavity. So he said the maximum angle of the slope is constant, as you can see here. It's just the receding back or parallel retreat of the mountain block or the region, you can see. So this was the existing region. This region retreated parallelly, and this is the current position that you can see. So all this moves away or erodes away, and this is the current position. But as you can see, since there is a parallel slope that is taking place, a parallel retreat that is taking place, the amount of slope or the slope angle usually remains the same. It is mainly seen in the areas of flash floods, where there is a semi-arid landscape and suddenly there is a flash flood that is seen in the area. He talked about the two slopes, the upper slope as the convex slope and the lower slope as the concave slope. So this was, these were the three slope evolution models given by Davis, Pank and King, and you can very well relate these to the cycle of erosion that we have covered in the previous class. In the further class, we would be talking about the few topics that remain in geomorphology. For any doubts, you can leave those as comment below the video. We will be more than happy to answer those doubts and any queries you have. Have a good day ahead.